equation, I think it applies to social systems. That's the Boltzmann constant. So these equation that this equation has to abide by what's called the Boltzmann or the Boltzmann chaos assumption, which means the particles have non-correlated velocities, which means that in the previous film depictions of particles moving along, that they collide with each other without noticing other humans, which is incorrect.
Y la otra, en términos de energía, aun calculando cosas tan distintas, los resultados coinciden. ¿No les parece fascinante? ¿No les parece?
No les sigo, profe.
So here the,
usted me conoce. Sabe que estudio lo que haga falta, pero...
Here the, this is the professor of thermodynamics. And then the student says, thermodynamics is too much for me, I don't understand. All these equations, and then the assistant, teaching assistant, starts flipping out and says, "Oh, don't you understand?" And he gives this rant about the way he believes Mateo Gil, I guess, believes thermodynamics applies to society.
La termodinámica no me entra.
¿Qué es lo que no le entra a usted?
Nada. Para empezar, no entiendo para qué sirve todo esto.
Igual no te entra porque no has captado un detalle sutil pero importante. Y es que todo esto no solo afecta a las sustancias que usamos en el laboratorio. Te afecta a ti, me afecta a mí, nos afecta a todos. La segunda ley de la termodinámica explica por qué un vaso se hace añicos al tirarlo al suelo y, en cambio, si tiras los añicos, no se arma un vaso. Explica por qué se estropean los aparatos si no los usas, por qué no duran los castillos de arena y por qué, al final, todo acaba olvidándose. Explica por qué lo que querías hacer se convierte en la chapuza que acabas haciendo. Y por qué tu pareja acaba aburriéndose de ti y buscándose a otro. Incluso explica por qué no podemos volver atrás en el tiempo y arreglar la cagada que tuvimos con ella. Explica prácticamente todo lo que haces mal. Porque se puede aplicar a todos los sistemas, empezando por el mismo universo y acabando por tu propia vida y la mierda de sistema social en la que la estás echando a perder. Piénsalo. Y para el próximo día me traes una reacción.
So there he just rattled off of like 10 different culturally myths associated with the second law of thermodynamics. But he believes all 10 of them, and he rattles them off to this guy over here like they're fact. So somewhere in between this guy, who's teaching just basic thermodynamics applied to engineering applications, and then this guy is like, why do I have to learn all this stuff? It's like waste of, what is the point? So he's in the middle of this whole thing. He's not correct, not 100% correct, but he's trying to say, look, the second law of thermodynamics, heat, applies to you socially. So, for example, two of these chicks in the film were hot for the teaching assistant, as we saw in the first part of the clip. No doubt some of these other students are hot, females are hot for some of the other students, or hot for someone else. So this heat we're talking about here applies socially, but it's never been formulated, not even maybe in a 5% way or 10% way. So that's where we are right now.
nombres anónimos.
There's another way to express the fundamental meaning of entropy. A logical consequence that is quite frankly alarming. If all available energy in the universe deteriorates continuously and irreversibly, in the far distant future, there might not be enough to sustain the processes we have today. And this would lead to what we call the heat death of the universe.
Para nuestro desconsuelo, queridos espectadores, a muy largo plazo ni siquiera habrá seres supermasivos.
So just to touch on this. This is kind of a confused topic. As we've already mentioned, entropy is actually correctly defined as the transformation equivalence, and that change of entropy is defined as the equivalence value of all uncompensated transformations, and that within a given cycle the equivalence value of all uncompensated transformations increases, and this is a positive value defined by n. So the n they're talking about here increases every cycle, but does not, so at the end of every, say, of every 1,000 cycles, you have 1,000 times n. And that doesn't mean that doesn't exactly translate to heat death. Let's look at this. Okay. It's more like a, supposedly there's a lecture that most of it derives from William Thompson, and wanted to sell biblical ideas about thermodynamics. Supposedly there's a lecture by Clausius, but in 1867, but I'm not exactly for sure if this is correct. So here we have a picture of what heat death looks like when everything is cold.
Y maravillosos como Elena, por los que sufrir. Pero volvemos a adelantarnos.
¡Chulo! ¡Chulo!
Vayamos atrás una vez más para entender qué pasó realmente. Para entender qué fue lo que comenzó a fallar en la física clásica y nos trajo hasta el actual estado de cosas.
The fundamental problem in classical physics is what we might call the point of view paradox.
¡Pablo! ¡Eva! ¡Eva! ¡Aquí! ¡Pablo! ¡Eva! ¡Elena!
Observers, which are moving one respect to the other, measure different things.
¿Qué nos cuesta, por favor?
No entiendo cómo Eva se deja arrastrar.
¡Pablo! ¡Pablo! ¡Pablo!
Este caso ocurrirá dentro de unos 8 segundos. Y supongamos dos observadoras diferentes, una quieta y la otra en movimiento respecto al suceso. Veamos ahora cómo observa el suceso cada una de ellas. Desde el punto de vista de la novia, Pablo cae en línea recta hacia el suelo. Para el amante, en cambio, puesto que el autobús está avanzando, Pablo cae siguiendo una parábola. La parábola es obviamente más larga que la línea recta, por lo que el amante necesariamente lo ve caer a mayor velocidad que la novia.
So, this part right here, he's trying to throw in relativity to explain social phenomena, which to note. He did in the film Agora. He did the whole thing. He did the same film clip in the film Agora, where she's on a boat and she drops a moving boat and she drops a rock off of the one of the poles of the boat where the sails go up. So the boat's moving forward like this, and then the rock, or say the thing is moving like this, the rock falls like this from the perspective of someone on the shore. So he's using the same thing. So Hypatia supposedly proved that the earth was moving and possibly went around the sun in 400 after Christ's myth. And so he's using the same thing here. Maybe it's just like the way it looks on film, but relativity doesn't apply to humans socially. That's the conclusion.
But what happens if we consider this problem but applying it to a ray of light?
The two observers have to see exactly the same event because the speed of light is constant. And that's exactly what Einstein realized.
Einstein proved that not only space contracts or stretches depending on the position of the observer, that time itself is also relative.
A mí la caída se me hizo eterna.
Pero te duele mucho.
Hijo, ¿pero en qué estabas pensando para caerte del autobús, por Dios?
¿Dónde está Eva?
A ver, señores, tengo que limpiarlo. Les aviso que puede ser muy desagradable.
Hijito, ¿qué hacemos?
Vayan. Vayan y cierren la puerta, que voy a gritar. ¿Pueden pedirle a Eva que venga a ayudar, por favor?
Estoy aquí.
Special relativity shows clearly one thing. No measure of time is more valid than any other. It only depends on the motion of the observer.
Ay, a mí se me ha pasado la semana volando.
Ya te vas, pero si acabas de llegar.
Igual estás yendo un poco deprisa, pero está todo bien.
But all of this is only part of Einstein's theory, which he called special relativity. The real...
We might as well bring this up while they're talking about Einstein here. And relativity is that Einstein started out with thermodynamics. And he spent most of it, like the first five years of his mind working on entropy before he got to relativity. So if you look over here, the key terms of his collected works from 1879 to 1902, before I got to relativity, the whole thing was filled up with adiabatic, which means no heat crosses the boundary. Calorimeter, measurements, system for measuring heat. Gases. Strength of materials. Kisses. Happy. And gases. I guess that's a nice combination. And then from 1900 to 1909, we see that a lot of his mind was caught up with entropy. Kinetic energy, theory of heat, Planck, black body radiation, adiabatic processes. And then from all these, the principles of relativity derived. After he learned the basics of thermodynamics, he started studying what would happen if I ran next to a particle of light. And that's where he started with energy and entropy, kinetic energy, and then he developed relativity.
Sledgehammer to classical physics was still to come. Later on, Einstein came up with an even more daring proposal, which he called the theory of general relativity.
What we know from Einstein is that freely falling under gravity is completely equivalent to being accelerated.
Para que lo entiendan, enamorarte tiene el mismo efecto que darte un carrerón por encima de tus posibilidades. En ambos casos, el corazón se dispara y quiere salir por la boca.
No hablar durante el tiempo de reflexión.
Ya, pero quería decir que yo ya he reflexionado. Mucho. Y no soporto la idea de perderte. Haré lo que tú quieras para no perderte.
Ya, Manel, pero no funciona así.
El pollo que me montaste el otro día, ese no es el Manel que me gusta. Me gusta el Manel que eres al principio, el que eres antes de perder los papeles. Creo que tienes que seguir reflexionando.
This led Einstein to a rather surprising conclusion. Gravity doesn't act like a normal force.
You no longer need to think of gravity as a force. In other words, you can describe gravitational attraction as being due to the way the space-time is curved because of the presence of another massive body.
O sea, que las estrellas como Elena deforman el espacio-tiempo a su alrededor con su sola presencia. Y los planetas como Manel creen que son libres y se mueven en línea recta, cuando en realidad están atrapados, orbitando en torno a su estrella.
Estoy bien, de verdad. Estoy de puta madre. Ya no la necesito, casi ni la echo de menos. Mi vida por fin se está enderezando.
The theory of relativity revolutionized science. But it also appeared at nearly the same time as the latest revolution, quantum physics.
¿Sabíais que la física cuántica empezó cuando un científico, Ernest Rutherford se llamaba, se le ocurrió imaginarse el átomo como un sistema solar en miniatura, con unas...
That's just incorrect. Quantum physics didn't start with Rutherford, it started with Planck. But that's a technical error in the film.
Partículas orbitando en torno a otras. Menudo hijo de puta.
Or, if we want to be even more specific than that, it was Boltzmann before that who said that, who had the idea that you could quantize energy states of a system. They had nothing to do with Rutherford.
Valgan de nuevo Elena y Manel como sistema de partículas subatómicas. La evolución de las visitas de él a casa de ella servirá como ejemplo de las inverosímiles leyes cuánticas.
There is one famous principle, which is called uncertainty principle. It's about two quantities which cannot be defined with infinite precision at the same time.
If you measure where a particle is, you don't know how fast it's traveling.
Okay. Here we're digging into Heisenberg uncertainty principle. This is a huge historical error, or it's called an Antic opening, technically, wherein people famously over the last 80 years have tried to apply quantum mechanics to social phenomenon. So basically, Heisenberg said that you can't measure the momentum and position of a particle exactly, okay? Because if you shine light on an electron, it's going to perturb a little bit. But the woman here is not an electron, so if you shine light on her, you'll still be able to measure her position. So people still abuse this principle. And this is what is called quantum flapdoodle, technically. The idea that over here, here's a cartoon of the whole thing. She says, "Oh, Alice, you're the one for me." She says, "Oh, but Bob, in a quantum world, how can you be sure?" So she's trying to, the guy who wrote this is trying to like cite Heisenberg. And this has all been debunked by mostly by Murray Gell-Mann, who called the whole thing quantum flapdoodle. Is it true that anything goes according to quantum mechanics? And then also by Steven Weinberg. So here's a cartoon of the whole thing. He says, you can't go through your whole life applying Heisenberg's uncertainty principle to everything. So the film is trying to apply this. It's basically a joke, but people, it's, I don't know what the, how to characterize. So if you go down here, all of these are called Antic openings, which means a way to use science to reconcile in your mind being and becoming, but using science in an abused way. So we've got chance, swerve of the atom, teleology, emergent property, entropy, radioactivity, and then we got uncertainty principle. So it's 19... ...27 by Heisenberg. And then it was debunked by